Hello there, and welcome to Followers Worship Online. We always appreciate that you join us on a Sunday or whenever you can throughout the week. Don't forget, we have tons of videos on YouTube that go back to the beginning of the pandemic. So we started this little mini series on Joseph lately, talking about how through a very complex plan that used betrayal, dishonesty, pain, and a whole lot of coincidences, God engineered a plan to bless his chosen people, save their lives, and instill in them an incredible story of his love and faithfulness. And then we went on to the next steps of looking at our own pasts and paying attention to the many forks in the road that have led us here and there, shaping our lives, focusing our service, and connecting us to the Father. We called it our spiritual genome, the DNA at the center of our spiritual lives that's guiding us. And so this week, Rick says, last week, we began an exercise to identify our faith genome and map our spiritual markers. Today, we continue with a focus on the significant events involved in our spiritual formation, either for the good, think of them as the green genes, or for bad, the blue genes. Just remember, you're not stuck with what you've inherited. I attended a Christian university, and there were times when a gentle debate would take place about whether it was better, spiritually, to grow up in a Christian family and be indoctrinated into the church from childhood, or whether it was better to have a real come to Jesus moment and reverse your life. We never did get to an acceptable answer because there are a lot of variables involved in that. But what we did know was that Jesus was the right and final destination for us all. Without Jesus, the end of our lives is just a hole in the ground or a scattering of ashes in the wind. With him, it's a new and forever life of glory.
Alone in my sorrow and dead in my sin, lost without hope of no place to begin. Your love made a way to let mercy come in. When death was arrested and my life began, ash was redeemed, only beauty remains. And my orphan heart was given a name. My morning grew quiet, my feet rose to dance. When death was arrested and my life began. From my chains, I'm a prisoner no more. My shame was a ransom he faithfully bore. He canceled my debt and he called me his friend. When death was arrested and my life began. Oh, your grace so shadows cross. And darkness rejoiced as though heaven had lost. But then Jesus arose with our freedom in hand. That's when death was arrested and my life began. Oh, your grace so free washes over me. You have made me new, now life begins with you. It's your
all the glory and honor.
Listen to all the wonderfully positive words in this reading from Romans 5 today. Peace, privilege, confidence, joy, strength, hope, and love.
Romans 5 selected verses. Since we have been made right in God's sight by faith, we have peace with God because of what Jesus Christ our Lord has done for us. Because of our faith, Christ has brought us into this place of undeserved privilege where we now stand, and we confidently and joyfully look forward to sharing God's glory. We can rejoice, too, when we run into problems and trials, for we know they help us develop endurance. And endurance develops strength of character, and character strengthens our confident hope of salvation. And this hope will not lead to disappointment, for we know how dearly God loves us because He's given us the Holy Spirit to fill our hearts with His love. When we were utterly helpless, Christ came at just the right time and died for us. Most people wouldn't be willing to die even for an upright person, though someone might perhaps be willing to die for someone who's especially good. But God showed His great love for us by sending Christ to die for us while we were still sinners. And since we've been made right in God's sight by the blood of Christ, He will certainly save us from God's condemnation. For since our friendship with God was restored by the death of His Son, we will certainly be saved through the life of His Son. So now we can rejoice in our wonderful new relationship with God because our Lord Jesus Christ has made us friends of God.
And I hear the Savior say, and thy strength indeed is small. Child of weakness, watch and pray. Find in me thine all in all. As Jesus paid it all to Him I owe. Sin had left a crimson stain. He washed it white as snow.
Hey! dead Jesus.
God, I look to you. I won't be overwhelmed. Give me vision to see things like you do. Sing it one more time, just the voices. And hallelujah, our God reigns. Hallelujah, our God reigns. And hallelujah, our God reigns forever all my days.
Heavenly Father, thank you for the gift of worship.
Thank you for the opportunity you give us to join together, to join our voices and our hearts and our combined love for you, and to acknowledge that publicly. Thank you for the presence that you provide us through the Holy Spirit as we join together and we lift your name. Lord, we want to thank you for who you are and the things you do for us. We thank you that when we feel sad and downtrodden, that you are the lifter of our head. And when we feel lost and abandoned and we're feeling isolated, you are the strong tower. You stand above everything and we can always find you. You are our place of refuge. And when we're feeling the need of protection or safety, understanding and comfort, we can find you. You deliver us from fears of doubt and disappointments, and you set our feet back on the rock as our deliverer. You also deliver us from our sin as our redeemer. I know I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. You have promised that you are never going to leave us or forsake us. You are an awesome God, and you have left us promises that we can stand on. Lord, your name is like honey to our lips. You provide us guidance as you light the path at our feet, and you sing over us how great you are. Your word says that when two or more of us are gathered together, that you are here amongst us. And with that strength of collective agreement amongst us, we ask you for the following things. Lord, we ask you for a revival and a refreshment amongst your people, a gathering of the remnants and a great outpouring of your love, and a desire for peoples of the world to dedicate themselves back to you. Lord, we pray for the leaders of governments, corporations, and organizations to become aware of how much more they can do to change the world for good and to provide far better outcomes than what we're doing. And Lord, we ask for healing of body and soul, for those who we know and love, and for those we don't yet know. Lord, may your presence become a comfort to the brokenhearted. We ask, Lord, for a fresh wind of your might to flood our nation and the globe. Through your continued rattlings, the world remembers that you are coming back, and we need to be ready. Thank you for your patience with us. Thank you for the glory you show us. Thank you for the mercy you give us. Thank you for your Son, for it is through him, Christ Jesus, that we are chosen and redeemed. And may we live our lives accordingly. Amen.
Have you ever found yourself reading the Bible sometimes and then not remembering what you read? Sometimes we read the Word of God in what we call a cursory way, hastily, inattentively. And this morning I'd like to teach you how to reflect more. It's not so much how much you read from the Word of God, but how much you actually meditate on and how much you actually reflect on. There's a verse in Galatians 2:20. Paul says, I have been crucified with Christ. It is no longer I who live, but Christ who lives in me. And the life I now live in the flesh, I live by faith in the Son of God who loved me and gave himself for me. Paul says, I have been crucified with Christ. When he was on that Damascus road and he had that experience, the old Paul, who used to be known as Saul of Tarsus, died. That Paul, who was a cruel persecutor of the church, was no longer the same man. That Paul, who was arrogant, and if you read Timothy, 1 Timothy chapter 1, he talks about how he was actually a very cruel persecutor and an arrogant man. He was arrogant because he trusted in all that he had. He was a Pharisee of Pharisees. He was of the tribe of Benjamin. He had studied under Gamaliel, one of the greatest rabbis of the time. And Paul could actually boast in all his accomplishments. But when he met Christ, he was crucified. He was no longer the same man. His desire was to live for Christ. In fact, he says in Philippians 1:21, "For me to live is Christ, and to die is gain." Each one of us, brothers and sisters, when we came to Christ, we were crucified. The Bible says also in Galatians 5:24, "Those who belong to Christ Jesus have crucified the flesh with its passions and its desires." We no longer live the way we used to live. That old life is dead. That's crucified with Christ. And now we're living for Christ. We have a desire to live for Him. And Paul gives us a reason why he's so motivated, why he's so single-minded about living for Christ. He says, "Who loved me." I could do a whole sermon on that this morning, but time is not going to permit it. Jesus Christ loved us, and He gave Himself for us. Why was Paul so desirous to serve Christ and to live for Him? Why did Paul want to crucify the old self? Because Jesus Christ loved him and gave Himself for him. In Galatians 1, verse 4, again Paul says, "Who gave Himself for our sins to rescue us from this present evil age." This is why this morning we are actually taking part in communion, because we remember that Jesus loved us so much that He gave Himself for us to rescue us from this present evil age. Without Jesus, there is no hope. And so this morning, we're going to bow our heads in prayer. We're going to thank Jesus. We're going to show our gratitude. And we're going to ask Him to help us live for Him. Our old life has been crucified, but now we're going to live for Him. Father, we thank You that this morning we can remember the great sacrifice of Your Son, Jesus Christ, who loved us and gave Himself for us. And Lord, our response is one of gratitude, one that says, "I want to live for You. It's no longer I who live, but Christ who lives in me." So Lord, that's our prayer. May it be our prayer every day. May it be our focus every day we pray. In the name of Jesus, amen.
Here's a bit of wisdom from a 6th century monk named Augustine, who wrote so much, he was like the Rick Gamble of his day. I learned that despite the passage of time, more than 5 million words from Augustine have survived. And some of them, he said, were these: "Where your pleasure is, there is your treasure. Where your treasure is, there is your heart. Where your heart is, there is your happiness." I hope your happiness is at the feet of Jesus, along with your heart. The end goal of this Joseph genome study is that you will have a better concept of how God may be working in your life right now, and that you may get a glimpse into His wonderful plans for you as you add your efforts to those of the work of His kingdom. So my blessing today comes from Ephesians 3, verse 16. "I pray that out of His glorious riches, He may strengthen you with power through His Spirit in your inner being, so that Christ may dwell in your hearts through faith." With that, I leave you with this week's visual sermon from Rick: spiritual green jeans and blue jeans. Have a blessed week.
Last time, we made the point that just as our genetics determine how we develop physically, there are spiritual markers in our lives that have a huge influence on the formation of our faith. Essentially, those markers are the significant people who leave an impression on us, and the significant events that do the same. even though we may not recognize their significance at the time. Now, if you haven't seen last week's introduction to what I'm calling your spiritual genome, you really need to go back and watch it before this one. It'll help you understand the role of your spiritual markers. In part one, we looked at the way our faith is shaped by various people. Parents or surrogate parents who filled that role. Friends, mentors, teachers, pastors, media influencers like authors and broadcasters, complete strangers or chance encounters, people of other faiths, or people of no faith. Today, we're going to look at significant events that had a significant impact on the evolution of your faith. And as we go along, feel free to add things to the list because there may be things I haven't even thought of. Also, keep in mind that not everything on this list will be of equal weight and value. Some things may have had a huge impact on your life, whereas others may barely register. And that's okay. Now, let's take those one at a time with varying levels of explanation. First, family dynamics. How did people treat each other at home? What was the effect on you and your faith? And what values were instilled by your family? Look for specific incidents that encouraged your faith or suppressed it. Think back to your earliest impressions of God, the Bible, or the church. And where did they come from? School life is another big factor. How did you fit in? What was school's influence on your sense of identity, security, and self-worth? Were you aware of God's presence, or did you feel largely on your own? And how did either of those help mold your spiritual side? Did anything happen that made you reach out to God, or to confirm your suspicion He just wasn't there? What about church experience or the lack of it? In what way did that shape your spiritual thinking? What specific things of value did you learn from your church experience, or how did the absence of that exposure prepare you for seeking God later? Were there pivotal incidents related to the church that left a deep impression on your heart or a bad taste in your mouth? And how did those things influence your perception of Jesus and God or your commitment to faith? Personal upheaval is another huge consideration, such as moving to a new neighborhood, school, or church. Often, a change in setting has a big impact because it shakes up our lives and exposes us to new influences, some of them good and some not so good. Can you look back and see how one simple change changed everything and had a major impact on your spiritual development? Okay, let's look at dating. In our younger years, our girlfriends and boyfriends can drastically alter our perception of ourselves, making us feel better or worse about our appearance, personality, and priorities. They often challenge some of our previous assumptions, including spiritual ones, and move us closer or further away from faith. What did that look like for you? Next, sports and hobbies. You may be surprised to find these on the list, but lots of people encounter powerful life lessons through these activities, which tend to take up a good chunk of our time. For me, it was running, as I outlined in a recent video. Sports and hobbies tell us something about ourselves. They usually highlight what we're good at and often have a spiritual application because of the values or traits we learn. So, what insights have your interests taught you about God, or life, or you? And is there some way you can use your hobbies to reach out to others with the gospel? The effects of jobs or a career cannot be overlooked. We spend an entire third of our lives working, so work is a big deal. It often has a lot to do with how we see ourselves and our value. It usually reflects our personality and preferences, and it determines who we spend a lot of our time with. Depending on what we do for a living, Work can also teach us valuable lessons about human nature, life in general, and relationships. And in a culture that uses work as a measurement to determine how important or successful you are, our jobs have spiritual implications, not just social and financial ones. Sometimes changing jobs helps our faith, and sometimes it hurts our faith. What's your experience? In a related matter, let's talk about talents and skills. Whether it's what we do at work or skills and expertise we've developed in other settings, these things are often one of the ways God prepares us to work in the spiritual realm through the church. So, what are your skills, and how can you use them to bless your brothers and sisters and serve others in the community? If you can't see how they fit into an existing ministry, talk to us about a new one, because we all have a giftedness from God, and we're to put them together for the common good. When we do that, the church is so much stronger. Let me just say that of all the factors we're talking about, this is the one that resonates most with me. I spent 30 years training and working as a news reporter, and everything I learned about writing and communication was directly transferable to my work as a pastor. I never wanted or intended to be a minister, but God had other plans, and He made sure I was equipped and prepared in every way. That does not mean I was always faithful to the calling or that I haven't fallen repeatedly on my face. But I've never doubted that I'm doing the work that God intended me to do. The next major influence is marriage. Whether we have a good marriage experience or a troubled one, or a mix of both, it's an influential relationship. Of course, we learn different lessons at different ages and stages of life, and marriages evolve over the years, for better or for worse. But our spouses tend to enhance or hobble our faith, depending on whether they reinforce what we believe or resist it. So be specific about the blessings and challenges and try to identify particular ways your spirituality was affected by married life. Closely related is the birth of children. The arrival of kids and grandkids often has a profound spiritual impact. It's hard not to sense something greater than ourselves when we see the beauty, complexity, and innocence of new life. It makes us think about where we came from, why we're here, and where all this is leading. Most new parents also begin to think seriously about what kind of life they're going to pass on to their kids. So it's no wonder researchers say the birth of children is one of the biggest influences on faith and spirituality. But that window of opportunity doesn't stay open long because things get so busy so fast. In retrospect then, how did you react? An equally significant factor is marital breakdowns or breakups. The disintegration of marriage, including one in which people stay together but essentially lead separate lives, affects different people in different ways, depending on the causes of the collapse and how the fractured relationship is handled. Marital breakdowns or divorce can lead to feelings of relief or release, or guilt, failure, and resentment, or all of those things. Divorce makes people question themselves and their judgment, or their worth. Marital failure of all kinds can draw you closer to God or drive you further from Him. Another mitigating circumstance is trauma, such as accidents, abuse, or chronic health problems. What we undergo and overcome helps define us, including our faith. It usually comes down to whether we try to handle those challenges entirely on our own or invite God to help. Either way, when serious, unforeseen circumstances or long-term challenges shake us to the very foundation, it often leads to soul-searching and questions about who we are, what really matters, and what we want out of life. So often, we drift through life taking everything for granted. We're busy and distracted. But when trauma and turmoil happen, we're forced to stop and evaluate our lives, and that often points people to God. If gratitude doesn't, need often does. Then there are emotional challenges, including anxiety, depression, and loneliness. In a culture where cases of mental illness and social isolation are through the roof, A powerful antidote can be found in a deep and abiding sense of God's presence and the love and acceptance found among His people. Emotional challenges are often the gateway to God, but they can also hold the potential to blind us to His goodness or make us walk away from people of faith who love us and are concerned about us. And if, for example, you found yourself in a church where you were told to just have more faith, put on a plastic smile, and simply suck it up and get on with your life, you know how damaging simplistic religious platitudes can be. What was your experience like? Financial successes or struggles also play a big role in our faith formation. The New Testament recognizes the incredible extent to which money can define us, deflate us, or defeat us. If we're successful, we can easily fall victim to pride and a sense of entitlement that makes us trust our money instead of our master, as Paul warns. But financial struggle is equally dangerous because it can lead to envy, anxiety, and ambition, all of which separate us from God and our proper priorities. As Paul also says, the love of money is the root of all kinds of evil, and many who crave money have pierced themselves with many sorrows. So, how has money affected your reliance on God, the priorities you've set, and your view of spirituality? One of the most obvious influences is spiritual upheaval, like troubles in the church, a reevaluation of beliefs, or a personal crisis of faith. Whether you're a spiritual rookie or a seasoned veteran, you're bound to be affected by turmoil in the church, whether it's over differing priorities, doctrine, personality clashes, or the moral failure of leaders. All of that can discourage you and stunt your growth, or force you to grow and rely more on God instead of putting others on a pedestal. Or maybe you've grown and found yourself no longer able to support the teachings of a particular church, forcing you to move on from people who've been a crucial part of your life for decades. Or perhaps you've experienced the dark night of the soul, where something or someone has challenged your beliefs so profoundly you lost your faith, at least temporarily. Maybe you bounce back from that stronger than ever. Or maybe you just haven't been the same since. And also consider grief and loss. They too can be a double-edged sword, forcing us to reach out to God to fill the painful void left by the death of someone we love, or hardening us into thinking that life isn't fair, so God isn't either. Bereavement should make us look at the big picture, with questions like, why are we here? What does God want from us? And what happens next? The conclusions we reach on those issues shape our spirituality. At the very least, death reminds us that nothing lasts forever, and we're not taking anything with us. That will either empower us or paralyze us. So, has the passing of your loved ones strengthened or stunted your faith? Next is retirement. For many people, work is much more than just making a living. It gives us some of our identity, our purpose, and our sense of worth. So when the job is gone, so is all that stuff. And that can be traumatic or at least unsettling. It's a cautionary tale that reminds us to build our self-image and security on God and to focus on who we are and not on what we do. But it's hard to break a lifetime habit. The key is to rechannel the time and energy we used to put into work into something meaningful and spiritual. By retirement age, we all have a set of skills and experiences we can use to bless other people, support the church, and write a new chapter that puts to good use all the things God has shown and given us. If you're retired or thinking forward to retirement, how is your faith being shaped by your focus and how you see yourself? And last, there's substantial influence on our spirituality when it comes to facing our own death. As we get older or face a serious illness, it's natural to confront our own mortality and start thinking deeply, perhaps for the first time, about our last days, our legacy, and what comes next. Those considerations often encourage people to embrace God and eternity. But it's not true that getting old or sick automatically makes people more spiritual. Like everything else in life, It all depends on how we see things. The bottom line is, if Jesus came back from the dead, we will too. And if you really believe that, it should determine how you live and how you die. So how does your sense of mortality color your faith? Well, there you have it. Those are the events or stages that typically have the most to do with how your faith turns out. But as you get ready to do your detailed genome, do a little analysis along the way. Can you see examples of God's providence in your life? Things you thought were random or meaningless, but turned out to be spiritually significant? Can you see times where God used success or adversity to prepare, teach, and mature you? Or does your past suggest what you should be doing today to use your spirituality? If, for example, you can identify something you've always enjoyed and been good at, is there some way you could use that in the church or the community? Also, what are the most important lessons you've learned about your own spirituality? Who in your life specifically can you pass on those lessons to? And last, what spiritual needs do you have right now? And how can we at Followers help? Keep in mind that you'll only get out of this exercise as much as you're willing to put into it. So if you're really not going to give some serious thought and prayer to this, maybe you should just tuck it away until you're ready. But if you are going to give it an honest shot, don't just focus on the big and bold developments, because it's often the small things that have the greatest impact. And nobody knows that better than I do. When I was 15, I saw a small ad in the local newspaper for a Bible correspondence course. Even though nobody in my family was going to church at the time, I was interested in the Bible and signed up. For the next several weeks, these arrived in the mail, one at a time. I read through each booklet, filled in the quiz on the back page, and mailed in that sheet before getting the next lesson. When I completed the eighth and final lesson, a local minister showed up at my house with a fancy certificate, because the course was just an outreach tool to find people who might be interested in studying the Bible further. That man's name was Tom Blake, and he was a pivotal influence in my life. He set up a Bible study with me, my mother Alice, my aunt Rose, and my younger brother Jim, and after a series of weeks, we made a full commitment to Christ and were baptized. The following Sunday, I walked into Tom's small church and saw a redhead. I distinctly remember my first thoughts were, she's got beautiful hair and great legs. Well, in the ensuing years, I began to lead communion, teach Sunday school, and preach. And then I went away to Carleton University to study journalism. The year I got back, I married that redhead because I never found anyone who came anywhere close to Susan and who she was. I also took on ministerial duties because we were in between pastors.
And I've really come to see in a powerful way that unless and until we get our concept of God the way it's supposed to be, everything else gets way out of whack.
After a series of pastors, I was back doing that work and holding down a full-time job in television. In February 1997, the church split and Followers was born. Just 1 month later, I got laid off at CTV, leaving me available to help guide the new congregation full-time. So, four conversions, a 45-year marriage, decades of spiritual training, and a new church, all because of a tiny ad in the newspaper. It changed the course of my entire life, and not just mine. In fact, you likely wouldn't be at Followers or be watching this video were it not for the fact that a nerdy 15-year-old was influenced by the faith of his mother and grandmother and answered a Bible ad. So hopefully you now know what to look for when it comes to mapping your spiritual genome. Each one of us has a unique one, which makes us who we are from a faith point of view. Get to understand yours, and you'll have a much fuller appreciation of just how much God has been working in your life all along. And that should give you even more confidence he'll continue to do so. Respond to that spiritual blueprint, and you'll be the spitting image of the one who created you.